Welcome, friends. Welcome back to the kitchen. Over the last little while, we've made a few different kinds of soup stock. We did chicken stock and we did pork stock. And if you go back far enough on the channel, you're going to find some stocks that we made in a slow cooker. And they're all really good. But we haven't done vegetable stock yet. And vegetable stock is one of those things that I struggled with for ages. I could never get the depth of flavor or the body that I wanted to in the stock. They always came out being a little bit thin and not as full of flavor as I really wanted them to. And that changed about 2009. Not long after I started this channel, we did some shoots in Iceland and Hong Kong. And in both of those cities, I ended up in kitchens run by classically trained French chefs. Or chefs that are trained in the classical French style. And they both made vegetable stock using the same basic method. Their ingredients changed based on their own personal preference and where they were. Iceland is vastly different than Hong Kong. And so the starting point for a really great vegetable stock is the ratio of vegetables to liquid based on weight. And so just like with the chicken stock or the pork stock that we made, where you have a certain weight of bones to a certain weight of water, vegetable stock is no different. And so it is essentially two parts vegetable by weight to three parts water by weight. So if you're 2 kilos of vegetables, you're gonna use 3 kilos or 3 liters of water. And once I got that ratio into my head, everything started to work a lot better. And then the other stuff that they told me how to do is to cut it as thin as possible. Everything needs to be cut as thin as possible. So for the really hard vegetables, I'm going to use a mandolin and get them cut super razor thin. For the softer vegetables like these mushrooms, I'm going to use a knife. I'm going to cut them really thin. And that helps in the roasting process. Now, the vegetables that you choose are important to you. They're important to the flavor profile that you want to achieve. But a good base starting point is, of course, the main vegetables of a mirepoix, which are onion, carrot, and celery. Those are going to give you a good flavor base. And when you're dealing with the onions, you just top and tail them, take the skin off, the papery skin, but you still want to use the papery skin. Just dump it into the pan with everything else. The skin is going to give you flavor and color. So color and flavor aren't always linked, but a deeper, darker color often gives the impression of a richer flavor. Now, I'm using a mandolin. Don't fear the mandolin, respect the mandolin. And you should be using the guard when you get down to a point where you feel uncomfortable, use the guard. If you feel uncomfortable right from the very beginning, always use the guard. And if you feel so uncomfortable with the mandolin that you don't want to use it, you don't have to. You could definitely use a knife and cut everything that way. Just try to be as precise and thin as possible with your cutting. Of course, a good sharp knife helps. So check out the series I did with my friend Gage from the Sharp Knife Shop in Hamilton. He brought me this really cool Japanese knife, and we did a whole series on choosing knives and sharpening knives, and that should be up on the channel now. So in here now I have classic mirepoix of onion, carrot, celery, with the added bonus of a little bit of red bell pepper. That's going to bring a sweetness. And for both chefs, this was a common base. And this is pretty much a common base in every vegetable stock you're going to see anywhere. You're going to see this mix of vegetables. From here on in, you start to add things that are going to give body and base notes and an earthiness and sort of round it all out and bring it together. One of the vegetables that they both did use were leeks. And the deal with a leek is it brings body. It brings a silky mouthfeel as well as the flavor of a leek. So I've already cleaned this one. I've got all the grit out. You just want to cut it as finely as you possibly can. And don't be in a race to chop. If you need to chop slowly or slice slowly to get really nice thin strands, take your time. precision is kind of important in this recipe because you really want these to cook evenly and brown, and that brown brings an extra depth of flavor. So, in keeping with that, I've got a beet. I'm only going to put in one beet, and beets will bring color, obviously. It'll start to give it a really rich looking color, but it's also going to bring an earthiness, a base note, an incredible sort of bottom note to the entire thing. So, mandolin for this one, definitely, because you want nice thin slices. Safety first. Of course, if you don't like beets, don't use beets. Next in is some fennel top. Now, I'm just going to use the top of the fennel. I'm going to use the base of the fennel in the actual soup. The fennel bulb is going to go in the soup. So the top is just going to bring some of that fennel flavor into the broth to make the soup bigger and more well-rounded. If you don't like fennel, don't use fennel. A lot of these vegetables are up to your own interpretation of what flavors you want to bring into the soup. If you know where the soup is going, and you think lemongrass would work in the broth, then put lemongrass in the broth. You can start to tailor this to whatever you want it to be. You don't like beets? Don't put in beets. It's going to be your soup. Make it the way you want it. Bring in the flavors that you want to bring into the soup. Celery bulb or celeriac, celery root would be fantastic in here. Again, earthy flavors. Things that I don't like to put in are brassicas. Like broccoli or cabbage, those sorts of things. I find in a long simmered soup, they start to get a little bit bitter, a little too bitter for me. I will put them into the soup as a whole vegetable that I'm gonna eat, but I don't generally put it into the broth. But if you like that flavor, it's your broth, put it in. Next in are dried mushrooms. And I've got dried porcini mushrooms. And the dried porcini mushrooms, again, an earthy umami flavor, really intensified. So you don't have to cut them up. You can just sort of crush them in your hand and put them in. Next is dried seaweed. And both chefs used dry seaweed. They both lived and worked in places where seaweed was everywhere. They both used different kinds of seaweed. And a lot of recipes I see say to use kombu, and kombu is fantastic. It is probably the one that most people are going to find, but any dried seaweed, the guy in Iceland was using something akin to dulse. And you get flavor, you get umami, you get natural glutamates, you get all kinds of things from this. You also get mouthfeel from this. There are substances in the seaweed that will sort of mimic, to a point, what you would get from animal fat and animal collagen in a regular sort of animal-based soup stock. So this is a very important part of the whole thing. Also to go in are peppercorns, and just whole peppercorns. You don't need to crush them. You don't need to grind them. They go in. Next, we come to fresh mushrooms. And you've heard me say this before, don't fear the mushrooms. Get a big selection. So I've got portobello, I've got oyster mushrooms here. Forget what these ones are. Anyway, got a bunch of them. Again, slice them thin. And if it seems like a lot of vegetables, it is a lot of vegetables. A huge amount of vegetables, but that's where you get a huge amount of flavor. The payoff is really big. So I've got all of the veg in here now. I've got mushrooms, leeks, onions, carrots, celery, beets, fennel, red pepper. Of course, you can add anything else that you want, any vegetable that you want, any vegetable that you think is going to bring a flavor that you want to this party. This is where, if I was making a animal-based stock, I would always add the Marmite. Whereas, for both of these chefs, they did it a little bit differently. They both added tomato paste. And so I've got a about 3 tablespoons of tomato paste in there. Then they both added something fermented. And in each case, they added products that aren't available to me here in Canada, but white miso paste is going to simulate what they did very well. The white miso paste is fermented, and it adds the same style of flavor, the same type of flavor in that you would get from the Marmite or nutritional yeast would be a great thing to put in if you can't get white miso. So I'm going to put in about the same of the white miso. There. And to that, I'm going to add a little bit of oil. And we'll just stir that up to make a nice paste. And I know that umami gets overused, but that's what's going on here. So into the vegetables with this kind of makeshift sauce. And then you want to mix it into the vegetables completely. Now, I've got this big roasting pan. You could do this on a sheet tray, a cookie tray. You want it big enough that the vegetables aren't too deep. You want the heat to go through the vegetables. You want the vegetables to dry out. What we're doing here is, on one hand, drying the vegetables to concentrate their flavors, and also adding some browning to the vegetables at the same time, which will caramelize the sugars and enhance the flavors. Now that this is all coated, it's time to stick it in the oven. So I've got the oven preheated at 300 degrees Fahrenheit. This is gonna go in for at least 2 hours. And at about the 1 hour point, I'm gonna come back, I'm gonna give it a stir, I'm gonna toss them around, I'm gonna check it out, check my timing. But I'm going to say at least 2 hours before we reach the point that this is ready for the next step. Okay, it's taken 2.5 hours to get to this point, and I think we've reached the point where the vegetables have all reduced down and browned. Now there's two things. First thing, this took 2.5 hours this time. Sometimes it takes 2 hours, sometimes 2.5, sometimes 3. And I know that bothers a lot of people. They want exact time. They want to know that they're going to put it in at a temperature for a time and it's going to be ready. Cooking isn't like that. You really have to sort of read the vegetables and know what's going on and kind of look at it and make a judgment call. It's going to take a little longer or it's ready, it's got to come out now. The second thing is, this really looks like something that is destined for the compost pile, but I'm telling you, it's going to taste great. So I've got almost everything transferred over. There's a lot of flavor left in the bottom of this pan. If I had a really good pan with even higher sides, where I could just fill it with water and put it back in the oven, that's what I would do 100% of the time. I wouldn't be moving it over to another pan to put on the stovetop. Although we could put it in this pan and stick it back in the oven, since the oven is hot and it's only gonna take about another hour. And maybe that's what I'm gonna do today. So, I'm gonna take a little bit of this water and I'm gonna put it in here and I'm gonna scrape off the bottom and see if I can get as much of the flavor that's left in here into this pot. The rest of the water just goes into the pot. Now earlier I gave a ratio of vegetable weight to water weight. You don't have to be super pedantic about that. Okay, now this pot is full, absolutely full right to the top, so I need to be very careful, but I am going to stick it back in the oven. The oven's already heated to 300 degrees Fahrenheit. 300 degrees Fahrenheit is the perfect temperature to extract the flavor into the water. And this will go, I'm going to say, about an hour. So let's be very careful here. And I'll see you in an hour. Oh, here we go. Look at that. That color is amazing. So I'm going to use a spider and scoop out as much of the vegetable mass as I possibly can. Now you don't have to do this straight out of the oven or straight off of the stovetop. You can wait for the soup to cool down a little bit. If you wait, it just makes it easier to handle you're not going to burn yourself, and if you splash everywhere, it's not going to be quite as bad. But let's see if we can pour this off without getting it everywhere. Didn't spill too much. Not bad. Okay, big reveal. Taste test. Let's see what we've got here. The color is deep and rich. The aromas coming off this are amazing. So the flavor should be great too. Yeah, deep, rich. Almost has that, you know how your lips stick together with a really good beef stock or a really good pork or chicken stock because it's, that's great. Now, a couple things to be aware of. Be careful with the seaweed. The first couple times I did it, I put too much seaweed in, and if you're not accustomed to the seaweed flavor, it'll be too strong. So be careful with the seaweed. Start it with a small piece and then kind of work your way up to get the texture that you're looking for. And also the other vegetables that you put in, you can play with them, like I said earlier, with anything you like. And as you can see by the color, this is not the kind of vegetable stock that you can use in a lot of really light flavored soups. You can pretty much put this head to head with any beef stock in any soup, and I doubt that most people would know that you had used vegetable stock. So stay tuned over the next couple of weeks. We're gonna make some soups with this. Thanks for stopping by. See you again soon.